Magandang umaga. Kumusta ka? Great, great. So it's a really privilege for me to be here. My name is Jerry. Like the MC introduced, I'm actually from Indonesia. I've been with ICA for almost 11 years. So ICA has been a really the home church for me ever since I came to Hong Kong. Amen. And the church has been a tremendous blessing to my family. Came here as single. Now God multiply. Now family of four. I have two daughters, one wife, soon to be five. Yeah. So I'm expecting another baby boy. So please pray for us. My wife's going to be delivering in a few weeks. So yeah, praise God. Thank you. So thank you, Pastor Betty, Pastor Mokran, Pastor Ed, and ICA for giving me the opportunity to share the Word of God today. So why don't we come to the Lord before we start, shall we? Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for today, God. Thank you that we are able to come today to worship you, to hear your Word, God. And we pray, God, as we learn about your message, God, about your Word, we pray that we only not hear the Word of God, but also apply it in our life. And God, give us and multiplications so that we bear the fruits, God, 100-fold, God. And please be with me as I'm sharing your word. Hide me behind your cross and let your word, not my word, in the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. So, yeah, so we are in the message series of the book of Jude. So as the MC said that we are at the last series of the book of Jude. Have you been enjoying the book of Jude? Yes. Even though it's very short, it's full of content, heavy, right? But it's so powerful. So today, as we are going to close, there are only two verses that end the book of Jude. So even though there's only two verses, I would like you to pay attention because it's very, very important. Because without it, you will not know the ending. Right? Without it, you will miss the point of Book of Jude. So it's like, you know, when you watch a movie. So like I mentioned, I have two daughters. They are 6 and 5, almost 5. They like to watch cartoon movies, right? So sometimes I accompany them before they go to bed to watch the movie. So, you know, we know how the story starts, the story develops, and there's, you know, a bad guy. And sometimes we have to stop because it's time for them to go to bed, right? So imagine if you are watching with us, right? If you stop before it ends, how does it work, right? You will not know the ending, right? You don't know whether it's a happy ending or a bad ending or a sad ending. You don't know, right? You miss the point of the story. So let's find out today how the book ends and read from our Bible first for today. If we can put it on the screen. So from Jude 24, now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. So Jude wrapped up his short and urgent book with a gracious promise and assurance from God. It's one of the greatest promises, I would think, in the Bible. Because it's so encouraging, it's so positive, and so assuring. You know, if you remember the previous last week's sermons, few weeks, right? That Jude wanted to write about what? Common salvations. But he turned completely writing a different topics. He was probably sensitive to the Holy Spirit. That's why we have the book of Jude in the Bible. There was a sense of urgency at that time about the situations that he needs to address. There were false teachers. There was ungodliness. There was sin related to sex, money, rejecting God and authority. So as we reflect, isn't it the same where we face in the world today? Maybe it's even worse, right? When we see the news today, it's very gloomy and hopeless. So at the end of the book of Jude, the author wants to tell us there is a good news. There is hope. There is hope in Jesus that God has given us the promise
that we are able to stand strong, not to stumble and present us blameless. Amen. So we are going to unpack these two verses today. And there are three points that I want to share today. Number one, He is able to keep your faith. He's able to keep your faith. Let's just focus on the first part of the sentence from Jude 24. Now to Him who is able to keep you from stumbling. In another translation, KJV, it used the word falling. So verse 24, this is one of the most quite well-known verse that used by many people as encouragement. It contains great promise from God. But do we know here what kind of stumbling that this verse is talking about? What is that God is giving you protection from? So it's very interesting when we go back to the original Greek word of from stumbling. It says in the Greek word, apta iostos. It means standing firm, exempt from falling. And when I look at the same Greek word in other books in the Bible, interestingly, I can't find it that it's being used anywhere else. So the only time the word aptahiostos is used in the Bible is only used in this verse. So there's another word, stumble, in the Bible. We see that a lot, but they use different Greek word, ptaio. Ptaio. So normally that word is associated by described by the author to describe if people stumble into sin, stumble into temptations, transgressions. But it's a different word from what is being used in Jude 24. So it's in here, they're not talking about God protecting you from stumbling into sin. And as we look in our life, sometimes we stumble, sometimes we fall into sins. We're not perfect, right? So if that's the case, that what kind of stumbling that this verse is talking about then? Well, we need to read the few verses before that to understand the context, right? So we don't have time to read. Obviously, you can go back to the last week's sermon. But it talks about what? Building your most holy faith. Praying in the Holy Spirit. Keeping yourself in the love of God. And waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. So all these things, they are talking about what? Your faith. Talking about your walk with God. That God promises that He will not let our faith to stumble or fall in our walk with God in the end. That is our faith that leads into salvation. So I'm going to want you to turn to another Bible verse from John 10. 27 to 29. It says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. And no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand." And then another first, I want to read for you from Psalm 37, 23-24. "The Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delights in Him. Though he may stumble, he will not fall, for the Lord upholds him with His hand." Wow. You know, if you really look at this verse, right? What an assurance that God gives to us about our faith. To know that our faith is secure in Him. Despite all the chaos in this world, the temptation and sin, God promises that He will not let your faith to stumble because He is able. Amen? So number two, we'll move on. He is able to present us blameless. He is able to present us blameless. So earlier we looked at the first part of the sentence. Like I mentioned, we're going to go through sentence by sentence to unpack this. Now we look at the second sentence, Jude 24. "To present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. And that's the beauty of the first, right? Even though we are not perfect, we are said that we are blameless in front of God. You know, when we look at the word blameless in the Bible, there's a lot of people that God labeled as blameless. For example, Noah, in his generation, he said he was blameless. Abraham, God said to Abraham, walk before me and be blameless. And God, in front of Satan, said about Job, have you considered this my servant who is blameless and upright man? And David, another example, used a lot of word of blameless in his songs and psalms. So what does it mean to be blameless? Blameless means here is flawless, without spot. So does it mean that those people that we mentioned are without sin? No, right? They're not perfect. We look at David. He planned a murder just to get somebody else's wife. Abraham, he's not patient enough to wait for the promise of son. He listened to his wife more than God. They're not perfect. Only Jesus is perfect. Amen. We are said that we are blameless not because we don't sin. We are said that blameless, we are blameless because God present us blameless because he has died for us in the cross. So Jesus is the ultimate one who is blameless. And our faith in him that leads into salvation comes only by accepting him as a personal savior. And there is no other way. So remember in the 2 weeks before about judgment, right? In the book of Jude, we talk about judgment. If it says God has the power to preserve judgment, eternal punishment for the ungodly people, if God could do that, it is the same God who is able to present you blameless and give you salvation at the end. The last point, he alone deserves all the praises. And we look to Jude 25. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, authority before all time, and now and forever. So in the ESV Bible, Jude 24 and 25, there's a section title of that, and it's called Doxology. So do you know what doxology is? Doxology is comes from original Greek word, doxologia. It comes from the word doxa and logos. Doxa means glory, praise, honor. Logos means word, speech. So doxology is an expression of hymn, song, praise to God. So if you, for example, if you're familiar with benediction, for example, benediction is a blessing from God to people. Doxology is the opposite. It's from people to God, giving praise to God. So Jude closes the book, the last sentence, he writes this, for all giving God all the highest praise to God for his promises, for his ability, for his redemptive plan, and all what he has done in his life. And I think it's a complete transformation of Jude's life as I study the book of the Bible and looking at Jude. So a little background about Jude, as we probably know already, some of them. Jude is the half-brother of Jesus. Yeah, so it's different with another Jude or Judas. So after Jesus was born, Mary and Joseph have other kids through their marriage. So Jesus had siblings. Yeah, so some of the names are even mentioned in the Bible, like James and Jude. So it is interesting that I found in John chapter 7, verse 5, it says that Jesus' brothers, before, they actually did not believe in him. They didn't believe in him not until the resurrections of Jesus Christ. But after they believe in him and acknowledge that Jesus is the Messiah and Savior, their life completely changed. How do we know that? Let's look how Jude started his opening letter, Jude 1:1. Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James. And notice here, he did not identify himself as Jesus Christ's brother. And I'm sure, right? You know, if I'm thinking as a Jude, there will be a privilege as Jude to introduce himself as the brother of Jesus. Especially in the early days where the church has grown, the popularity and the numbers of congregations. Imagine you walk into the church, right? Hey, do you know Jesus? He's my brother. You know Jesus? He's my kuya. You know, I am his silo. Right? I think, can he say that? Of course. Right? He grew up with Jesus. They played together. Potentially they ate together. But they did not believe in him at first. Before. But it completely changed until he accepted Jesus. He did not regard his earthly title as something that is important. Unlike today's world, right? Everything's about connections. I know so-and-so, so I can get a special privilege, so I can get shortcut. Jude is saying here, what's more important is his relationship with Jesus as his Savior. I am the servant of Jesus Christ. You are my Savior. So when we understand how precious our salvation is, your desire to praise Him in your life will be magnified. And everything else in this world become less important. So if you have problem giving thanks to God, at least give Him praise for one thing. Just one thing. And that one thing is your salvation, because that is the most precious thing that you can ever have. So Jesus, Jude, coming from his old life as unbeliever, to have new life in Christ, expressing in his grace and mercy, can help to praise him, because he deserves all the great, the praise and honor. So now the book of Jude, as we read, contains a great promise from and protection from God. But there's condition for it. And it's not for everyone. So as I preparing the sermon, I feel like God brought the story of Judas Iscariot and Peter to me to illustrate this. So we know Judas Iscariot, different Judas this time, don't get mixed up. Yeah. Judas Iscariot and Peter, they have a lot of similarities, right? They are handpicked by God to become his disciples. They follow God, and they serve together with Jesus. They probably heal people together, cast out demons. They saw Jesus' miracles. They heard the same gospel. But they had a different ending in their life. Another similarity that is very obvious was they both stumbled in their faith in God, even to the point where they betray Jesus. But if you look, right, the end of the story of their life, they have a different story. One, Judas Iscariot, completely fell and stumbled. And one was upheld and restored by God. And why is that? Isn't it God that we say that is not favoring one person or another? Is it applies in this case? The answer is no. God is not favoring one person or another. But there's one key difference in their life. That is, one choose put his faith in Jesus and one doesn't. You know, the easiest thing is when we look at the relationship, right? If I have my daughters here come to me, they'll call me daddy. That proves my relationship with them is father and daughter. If you notice in the Last Supper how Judas addressed Jesus, he called him as Rabbi. And the second time when he handed over Jesus to be captured, he kissed him and said, "Greetings, Rabbi." What's this important? Rabbi is the title that's given by the Jew to honor their teacher. It's actually a prestigious title that everybody wants. But notice how Peter addressed Jesus when Jesus asked his disciple, "Who do you think the Son of Man is?" Some said John the Baptist. Some said Elijah. Some said Jeremiah. But Jesus said, you are the Christ, the Son of living God. And that is the key difference. So the book of Jude here contains great promise. But there is one condition for it, that you need to put your faith in Jesus. If you don't put your faith in Jesus, what's there left for Jesus to protect? So as we close this message series of the book of Jude, we look at the life of Peter, right? How did Jesus restore his faith? Peter, as we know, he went back to his old life, doing what? Fishing. Same like us. If we look at our life, when we wander away from our life, we tend to go back to our old life. But notice, it was Jesus who came to Peter at the shore, waiting for him, calling him back, restoring him. So for me, the story of the shore between Judas, between Peter and Jesus was it's a symbolic moment where God comes in your life and restoring you. If you have been to the shore, right? It's the place where the land meets the sea. If you're standing right at the shore, you can see the contrast difference of the two, the water and the land. The lives, the animals that live in there is different. The colors are different. Same like our life. Our life without Jesus and with Jesus are very different. But God was the one who took the initiative. He took the first step to meet Peter and restore him. So for me, the story of the Peter, just to show how great God's promise that ends the book of Jude. So I would like to end the sermon today as we wrap up the book. I want to go back to where we first started. Let's go back to Jude 1, verse 1 again. It says, to those who are called in God the Father, kept for Jesus Christ. Called, beloved, and kept. Once you are called, you are called. Once you are kept, you are kept. Once you are beloved, you are beloved. And that is the promise of God who put his faith in him. Amen? All right, I'm going to invite everyone to just come to the Lord. I'm going to invite everyone to stand up while the worship team also go to the stage. And I just want to take these 2-3 minutes just to reflect the book of Jude, the one that we've been studying and hearing for the last few weeks. And God, at the end of the book of Jude, God gave us such an amazing promise that he will sustain our faith until the finish line. It says that he will keep our faith from stumbling and not fall to the ground. And God will present us blameless. And no one can take it from God's hand. God will uphold you. That is such an amazing promise that you cannot get. Like you're gonna buy from anywhere, at any price. So church, friends, the world is not going to get better, especially morally, spiritually. We need to get stronger, to be content with our faith, to build our faith, that most holy faith. But at the end, we need someone to protect it. We need someone to uphold it. We need Jesus. And we need him. And it says in the Bible, in Jude, God will do that with great joy for you. But as we learn today, there's one condition for it. The promise is only intended for those who accepted God as personal Savior. The question is today for all of you, where do you put your faith? You put your faith in your job, in your business, or even at your ministry. We want to learn as well from Judas Iscariot. It doesn't matter how long you serve at the church, how long been following God, but if you never put your faith in Jesus, then you can get stumbled. I give you the opportunity today, if you never accepted the Lord as a personal Savior, I want to invite you to accept Him. Because I don't care how long you've been at a church, if you never do that, or you have a slightest doubt with your faith, I want all of us to leave this place to know that you have faith in Jesus and your faith is secure in Him. Let's rededicate our faith to Jesus. Let's accept Him as personal Savior if you have never done so. And at the end, for the rest of you, I would like to finish the book of Jude the same way like the author finished the book of Jude. I want where you are, right there, just give praise to God. Just give praise to God. Give Him thanks. Give Him praise. Give Him all the glory. God, we thank You for Your gracious promise. We thank You for Your salvation, God. We thank You for protecting our faith. We thank You that at the end You present us blameless. We might not be perfect, God. Thank You for Your blood. Thank You for Your life, God. Thank You for who You are. Thank You for You are almighty, powerful, and Savior. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. Thank you.